Betty. Welcome to Betty's Kitchen. Today we're making red currant chocolate ganache. And ganache is just a glaze that you can put on cakes and cupcakes and cookies, anything sweet. And it's made of two items, basically. And those items are chocolate and cream. And you can change the ratio of chocolate and cream. And as a result, you could have a glaze that is fairly thin, or you could have a filling that is fairly thick. So I'm just going to do what I think is appropriate for topping a cake today. And it is the sort of thing that you can pour over the top of a cake and it will drizzle down the sides and give a really pretty look. And there are things that you can do to it to change whether it's dull or shiny, the sweetness of it, the flavor of it, and we'll try to incorporate some of those as we go along. So we'll have more than just chocolate and cream. But let's start by looking at our chocolate. You want to have a good type of chocolate. Now, in the grocery store, this is probably one of the better brands that you can buy. So I wouldn't go to the very cheapest chocolate that they sell. This is semi-sweet chocolate chips of Ghirardelli. Now, if you are into baking things in a big way, then you probably know a lot of those fancy brands that are finer chocolates that probably will give you a little bit better result. But I don't think you can do much better than Ghirardelli. So I'm going to be using 1 cup of the chocolate chips. Next, I prepare my cream. This is heavy cream. It is 3/4 cup, and I've chosen that amount to go with 1 cup of chocolate. So I put it in a saucepan because we're going to have to heat this. And then I want this to be red currant flavored. Actually, I would have preferred to have something that is a little bit less dark than this because of a future use that I have for my ganache, which you'll see eventually. So if you happen to run across cherry jelly or strawberry or raspberry, that would be great. I will need 1/4 cup for my purposes here. Next comes honey. Now this is 2 tablespoons of honey. Now to make this a little bit glossy, you add oil or butter. This is 1 teaspoon of butter that's going in. And then the final thing is just a little bit of salt. This is 1/4 teaspoon of salt that brings out the flavor of the chocolate when it gets mixed in eventually. So we're taking all of this to the stove. You can see what it looks like as we stir around. And we're going to heat this just to boiling. We don't want it to be boiling for any time. It can boil a little bit, but then you take it off the heat. And I will say that normally I wait until the end to put the butter in. I think I'm going to fish that out and just wait till the end because I don't want it to affect my heating of the cream. And I just kind of made a mistake there, although it probably would have come out fine. So I'm stirring this around just to try to incorporate the jelly in there and all the other items. But now we go to the stove, turn on your burner to probably low to medium heat. I'd say medium because you want to bring this toward a boil, but once you see those bubbles around the edge, you know you're finished because you don't want a rolling boil. And you should whisk as you go. You can see that the cream mixture is bubbling around the edges. That's good, and we want to turn this off. And we're going to come over to our workspace where our chocolates are. And here is our heated cream mixture. What we're going to do is immediately put the chocolate chips in. But we want to wait just a little bit before we whisk in our chocolate chips. You want to spread them out. Make sure that they get good contact with that hot cream. Now I'm going to put a lid on this and wait just a minute or two. You don't want to wait too long, but the reason for waiting at all is that you want the contact of the chocolate and the hot cream mixture to melt those chocolates before you start whisking. If you start whisking immediately, then you're putting air into it and that cools it down very quickly, and it's going to be very hard to melt the chocolate. So we'll just wait a minute and we'll be right back. We're going to take the lid off and see what we've got. It's been about a minute and a half or two, and it looks like the chocolate has softened a bit. Yeah, it's nice. So just stir that around with your whisk, and when you get it blended together, then you actually whisk it until it's smooth. So just get it together, and it should be nice and smooth except for the lumps of chocolate that will be retained just for a moment or so. Now when you get those lumps out and you're ready to whisk it, let's put our butter in. I don't know how that would have affected our heating, probably not at all, but this is the point where I add 1 teaspoon of butter, so here it goes, and that will maintain the shine that you see, because normally after that gets poured, it will get a little duller. Although the additives that we had, the honey and also the jelly, help a little bit in making it shiny. And I think it's pretty much ready. I see a little lump here and there that have to do with the chocolate chips, but it's still so hot, those will melt. Doesn't that look good? Now it's pretty runny right now, so I'm gonna let it sit just a little bit. And then I have a cake sitting over here, and it's gonna be Carter's birthday cake. And I'm going to pour ganache icing over the top. Here is our ganache after it has been cooling down for quite some time. It's still nice and smooth, and you can just run your whisk through it, and it's just like velvet. But it's thickened up a bit, and I think it is at the stage where we can pour it over a cake. Right here is a portion of a cake that I made. I made a cake and baked it in a 13x9x2 pan, and then I decided, since this was for Carter's birthday, we would put ganache over the top, and then after that had set a bit, we would put maybe some decorations for him that are special for his birthday. But at this point, it has been cut off on both ends and trimmed a little on the sides. So it may look strange to you in that format, but it originally started out as a 13x9x2 regular cake, which I had made from scratch. And I might show you the recipe in cupcake form later if I have time to get a few things in before Valentine's Day. But here's our ganache. So I would just go to the center and start pouring. So I have my cake spreader, and I'm going to the center where I just put that puddle, and I just want to make it a little smoother. I think that will be prettier. And this is very thin. I could have used the whole mixture that I had, and it would be a little more fancy. This is always an elegant way to serve icing. But we've got it flattened out so that if we want to put decorations on it because of Carter's birthday, it will be easy to work with. But we can just let it sit like that, and it will get a little bit of a hardening on the top. It will set up, but it will always be a soft glaze. So I hope you enjoy it, and maybe I'll come back and show you how it looks if we make some changes to it for Carter's birthday. This is my red currant chocolate ganache, and I hope you like it. Now, I told you I was saving back some of this because I have another idea, actually, to do for Valentine's. I hope I get a chance to do it. So if you have leftover ganache, that's not a problem. Just save it, and if you'll put it in a sealed container like this one, or just anything that is covered and will not allow the air in, you can put it in your refrigerator, and you can keep it as much as a week. And then when you need it, just get it out and it will have hardened. It will, won't be really hard, but it will not be nice and liquid like this. So what you do is just dip out what you need in a microwave safe container, put it in the microwave for a few seconds at a time and stir. And just continue that cycle until it looks like this. And then you can use it again.